Hi, I'm Emil, the founder and CEO of Tomorrow Bio. Today, I will walk you through a couple of the most important and specific procedures and technologies are being used in the field of cryopreservation. Of course, in the field of cryopreservation, a lot of the technology that is being used and the procedures that are being employed are quite similar to normal medical practice. You know, there are chest compression devices, there are ventilators to give oxygen, and so on and so on. The first part where it becomes a bit unique is once perfusion starts via so-called perfusion circuits. The logic here is that before you want to cool down lower than 0 degrees Celsius, before ice might freeze, which of course in the field of cryopreservation needs to be avoided at all cost, you want to replace all the water in the blood in the patient against the so-called cryoprotective agent. These cryoprotective agents are practically medical-grade antifreeze solutions. So solutions that even if you cool down very, very, very low, in the end, in most cases, to negative 196 degrees Celsius, even at these temperatures, they do not freeze. So what you want to do here, you, in our case, open the chest. Then just like in a heart operation, you cannulate the heart. So you put basically a tube into the heart. Just like you would in a heart-lung machine, in open heart surgery, in an operation room, in a hospital. And now with that tube, it's connected to a so-called perfusion circuit. Practically or simply speaking, it's an arrangement of different filters and so-called bubble traps to remove small bubbles from the solution and either one or multiple pumps that within a very specific pressure and flow rate can now perfuse a cryoprotective agent into the body. So on one side of the body, the arterial side, so in the aorta, for example, you put a cryoprotective agent into the patient. And on the other side, the venous side, the cryoprotective agent, the lower concentrations that are now mixed with water and blood, come out of the body. And now you run this perfusion circuit, sometimes for hours, until all the water and all the blood in the body is replaced against this cryoprotective agent. You need to be quite careful with that perfusion circuit, because once you perfuse higher concentrations of this cryoprotective agent, you start very low, and then over time, you increase the concentration of this cryoprotective agent, then the pressure might go up, so you need to bring the pressure down. It's quite a complex procedure that we train quite regularly, but in the end, all the water and the blood in the patient are being replaced or are replaced against that cryoprotective agent. And now the patient can be cooled down lower than 0 degrees and at the end down to cryogenic temperatures. Now, after perfusion is done, the body now needs to be cooled down. And cooling down is kind of a complex process. So initially, you want to cool down as fast as possible, right? That initial fast cooling is there so that the metabolic rate of the body, so the metabolic activity, goes down as quick as possible. And on a cellular level, cells don't die. Now you can cool down as quick as you can to around negative 120, negative 125 degrees. At that temperature, or at least about that temperature, is what is called the glass transition temperature. These cryoprotective agents that are being perfused in the body are so-called vitrification solutions. Once they cross a temperature that is called the glass transition temperature, they practically do a phase change into a glass-like amorphous, almost solid, or practically actually solid, phase. At that temperature, or at that point, you want to cool down very, very, very slowly. And the reason for this very slow cooling is because now you have a solid. And if you cool fast, this solid would cool down at different points in different rates. So the outside would, for example, cool very fast because it's exposed to the coolant on the outside, right? The inside would cool slower, which would generate so-called thermal stress. And that thermal stress can lead to what is called fracturing or cracking, which you want to avoid. So from the glass transition temperature to the final storage temperature, which in most cases is negative 196 degrees Celsius, you want to cool extremely, extremely slowly. And to do that, there are so-called cryogenic cooldown boxes. These are basically large, well-insulated boxes with a lot of temperature probes and a lot of technology to cool down in a very, very controlled, actually computer-controlled way, very, very slowly. So the cooldown from this, you know, let's say negative 120 degrees to negative 196 degrees, in our case, is being done around over the time frame of around 100 hours. So very, very slowly, to always leave time to have the thermal stress that is being generated released, so you don't get cracking, or at least avoid cracking and fracturing as much as possible. After cooldown, now want to keep the patient that has been cooled down to cryogenic temperatures safe and sound for potentially many decades, if not centuries, until potentially in the future, it's possible to bring someone back from cryogenic storage and revive the person. Now, that long-term keeping safe and sound is being done in so-called dewars. These are about 3.20 meters high, around 1 meter in diameter, large stainless steel capsules that are very, very, very well insulated. In fact, these dewars have a dual wall, a double wall, with a hard vacuum between. And that hard vacuum allows to keep extremely cold temperatures inside. In fact, they're filled with liquid nitrogen, which naturally has a temperature of negative 196. And that temperature needs to, of course, be well insulated against the outside. If it's not well insulated, it would boil off quickly. So once liquid nitrogen warms up, it goes from liquid to a gas phase and boils off. So these dewars need to be refilled constantly to keep the level of liquid nitrogen high enough to keep the patient safe and sound in that temperature of negative 196. They usually can be rolled around. So even if, you know, there are at some point in the future some geopolitical problems in some location, and technically they can be transported to other organizations, even though that's a logistical, you know, complex task, but in principle it is possible. But of course, in our case, storage is in Switzerland, which is very geopolitically, you know, socially, economically, and so on, stable. And in fact, the storage where patients are being stored, the storage room, is in fact underground. And now I want to introduce you to two technologies or procedures that are currently being developed and that will be implemented into cryopreservation practice, probably very soon. The first one is called so-called ITS dewars. This is a specific type of storage capsule for patients at cryogenic temperatures, so-called intermediate temperature storage, ITS. Now, normal storage or standard storage, in most cases, what is being done today for cryogenically preserved patients, is so-called immersion storage. Immersion means the patient are being fully immersed in liquid nitrogen, which, as I said many times before, is at a temperature of negative 196 degrees Celsius. The problem if you cool down to negative 196 Celsius is that you need to cool quite a bit from the glass transition temperature. Just as a quick reminder, the glass transition temperature is somewhere about negative 120 to negative 130 degrees. Now, from that point, you need to cool down quite a bit until you reach cryogenic temperatures. And since cooling under the glass transition temperature generates thermal stress, you don't technically want to cool down that low. Once you've reached the glass transition temperature, all the metabolic processes are already virtually stopped. Not only virtually, therefore, all intents and purposes, they're stopped. Now, you don't technically need to cool down further. The reason why storage is being done at cryogenic temperatures, which is negative 196, is in the past, it's just simple to do, right? You just need to buy liquid nitrogen, you refill, you do it with liquid nitrogen, then liquid nitrogen boils off, and you refill again. Very simple. What you would rather do is that you want to store patients long-term slightly below the glass transition temperature. So let's say, for example, around negative 140 degrees. Now, that is technologically much more difficult to do, but it would be better. So ITS dewars do just that. They store bodies long-term at around negative 140 degrees. So how is that being done? So when you think about one of the dewars from the outside, an ITS dewar and the immersion dewars look pretty similar. The difference is that in an immersion dewar, the liquid nitrogen level is just on the bottom. The patients are, in fact, above the liquid nitrogen in the so-called gas phase of well, liquid nitrogen, which in that case would then be gas form nitrogen. That gas form is still very, very, very cold. And now if you do certain techniques like different types of insulation and heating elements and so on, you can reduce that temperature to only, in quotation marks, negative 140 degrees. You need to do a couple of things to keep the temperature uniform in the whole dewar. One of those dewars is around 3.20 meters high. And of course, you want to have the whole patient uniformly stored at negative 140 in an ITS dewar. So there's a couple of things that need to be done to achieve that. But that is what is being done in an ITS dewar and starting to work quite well. In fact, the European Biostasis Foundation, which is the long-term storage facility in Switzerland, will soon have the worldwide first whole body ITS dewar, and then offer ITS storage for patients as an option as well. The downside here is that it likely is going to be a good amount more expensive because these dewars are more expensive. They use more liquid nitrogen and so on, but the storage quality is at least a bit better. So another procedure technology that is currently being developed and will be implemented soon are so-called blood-brain barrier openers. These blood-brain barrier openers will be added to the cryoprotective agent to make perfusion of the brain more effective. So why do we need that? So in a cryopreservation case, once the heart has stopped, you want to reduce the metabolic load by cooling as quick as possible so that no oxygen is being used by the cells anymore and the cells don't die. Now, after you've done that, you want to perfuse with cryoprotective agent so that you can cool down quick. Now, that cryoprotective agent, of course, comes through the circulatory system, through the vessels in the body, the blood vessels. Now, these blood vessels in the brain are lined with a so-called blood-brain barrier. So around the vessels, there's a certain layer, kind of, that doesn't let substances from the vessels get into the brain tissue. Normally, when people are alive, this is a very, very important barrier. For example, it reduces the amount of bacteria and other harmful substances to go from the vessels into the brain, which of course is very important. But during cryopreservation, you of course want the cryoprotective agent to go from the vessel into the tissue so that no ice crystals form in that tissue in the brain. Now, these blood-brain barrier openers are being added to the cryoprotective agent so that during perfusion, under certain circumstances, you open this barrier just the right amount. You don't want to open it too much. If you open it too much, you would get edema, swelling, which you don't want because it would reduce the efficiency of perfusion. And you don't want to open it too little because if you open it too little, not enough cryoprotective agent gets into the tissue. That's the complexity here, to open it just the right amount so that cryoprotective agent can be used in the brain, in the tissue, to reduce ice formation efficiently and effectively. So cryopreservation is a field that is constantly in development, not only by us, but also by our partner labs and other organizations. The field is constantly being pushed forward with new technologies and new procedures, improving the efficiency and effectiveness and quality of cryopreservation. If you want to learn more about what we do, check out tomorrow.bio, schedule a consultation with us. Me and our team are more than happy to have discussions with you, answer all questions that you might have. And of course, if you want to stay up to date with new technologies and new procedures coming out, subscribe to the channel and learn more down the line. Thank you so much.